Okay, maybe we can start then. Okay, so it's a great honor. This is a seminar hosted by Stockholm University, and it's a pleasure to have Jan de Hoover here today, that will speak about his new book that he has authored together with Sean Hughes. And briefly about you, Jan, maybe you will say something more about yourself. I know that you have been doing this kind of learning research for close to 30 years, and you're very, very interested in this integration between functional psychology and cognitive psychology, and has published on the functional cognitive framework that you have suggested as an integration. We're very happy that to have you here to speak about your book and to hear your thoughts on how to integrate these perspectives on learning. So thanks for doing this, Jan.
Thank you very much for the invitation. So you can hear me well and see me well, yeah?
Yeah.
So it's indeed the idea of today's talk is to give a brief overview of the book. We've recently published. I did this together with Sean. Unfortunately, Sean cannot be here today. He's still, initially we had the idea of doing it together, but it will be just me, unfortunately. And those of you who haven't seen the cover yet, this is the cover of the book. So it's there are paper copies available at the website of the MIT Press. But we've also negotiated an open access PDF, and this can be found on this website here, thepsychologyoflearning.be. And you can not only download the book there, but also support materials. So if there are people amongst you who wish to use parts of the book or the whole book in their classes, you can also download support material. Now at the moment, so this is PowerPoint slides that we use in here in Ghent, hundreds of questions of students about this. We've also put an exam on there. Of course, all of this material, unfortunately, is still in Dutch. But we hope that with the website, we can build a community of people who are using the book or parts of the book. And if they then translate these things into other languages, with Google Translate, for example, that you can then send us these materials in other languages, and that gradually we built up this resource that is basically all open access and available for everybody throughout the world in different types of languages. So we really hope that, first of all, you will enjoy the book, and if you will become engaged, if you to also contribute to this project. The book has limitations. Let me be clear about this. We also say it in the preface of the book. It's really an introduction to the psychology of learning. There are other books that provide much more detailed, in-depth coverage of the learning language, the learning literature. So it's only an introduction, and we don't cover neuroscience. That's another clear limitation. But we do believe that our book has some other strengths. And today I want to highlight some of those strengths, and that's the unique conceptual foundation of the book. As Robert said, we have constructed this book from a functional cognitive perspective, and in some sense, the book was our way to show to the world, look, this functional cognitive framework can really generate interesting avenues, and it's an interesting way to look at science in general. And this is like a kind of case study within learning psychology to show the merits of this functional cognitive framework. We believe it can have the same merit in other areas of psychology, but the book is like a book length case study of how the functional cognitive framework can really work for, in this case, learning psychology. By applying this framework to the learning literature, I think we provide a really unique overview of the literature. I will highlight the ways in which it is unique. And then I'll focus on a few new ideas in the book, because it's It's a mixture of a textbook and a monograph in that we use the functional cognitive framework to organize the existing literature, but also to show how the framework generates new ideas. And some of those new ideas can also be found in the book. So let's start with the conceptual foundation, and really the bedrock of this whole book is our definition of learning. We've published that a while ago, and where we introduced the learning, a functional definition of learning. And this definition states that learning is a change in behavior that is due to a regularity in the environment. So there are certain things that we call regularities that are present in the environment, and they produce changes in behavior. So learning is an effect, right? It's the impact of something in the environment on behavior. This is a functional definition because behavior is seen as a function of those environmental regularities. So cognitive people are already a bit uneasy here because we don't really define learning as some kind of mental process or storage of information. We really get all the mental assumptions out of the definition of learning, and we are just left with the core idea that learning are changes in behavior due to regularities in the environment. So this is our functional definition. The core concept here is the concept of an environmental regularity. Now, like with all definitions, you can have debates about this, but environmental regularities for us focus on the orderly aspects in the environment. So it's not necessarily regularity in the sense of repeating things, but in the sense that there are certain patterns, certain orderly things in the environment. And anything, any spatial-temporal event that is more than one stimulus at one point in time can be called a regularity. So you can have regularities in the presence of one stimulus. A stimulus repeats itself. That's a regularity. There's an orderly appearance of the stimulus in the sense of it appears more than once. You can have a regularity in the presence of two stimuli. That can be two stimuli at one point in time, because that's already more than one stimulus at one point in time. Or it can be the repeated presence of two stimuli across time. And then a third example of a regularity are regularities in the presence of stimuli and responses. So you do something and something happens, then there is a regularity in the presence of the response and the presence of the stimulus. So these are examples of environmental regularities. Now, not only learning can be defined in terms of regularities, but also types of learning can be defined in terms of types of regularities. So what we want to do is not claim that this is like the definite best possible definition. Our point is to convince you that this is a useful definition. And why is it useful? We'll give several arguments. First of all, it's a definition with a high heuristic value. Heuristic value means that it allows you to organize existing knowledge about, in this case, about learning. It already says what learning is and what learning isn't. So learning is not the same as behavior, because learning involves changes in behavior. It's not just any change in behavior, but it's a change in behavior that is due to a regularity in the environment. So it is a subclass of changes in behavior due to regularities in the environment. And this means that it's not the same as evolution, because evolution is basically changes in behavior that are due to regularities in the environment of previous generations. So we also relate learning, which we defined as ontogenetic adaptation, so that is adaptation to regularities in the environment during the lifetime of the individual. And this is different from phylogenetic adaptation, which are changes in behavior due to regularities in the environment of previous generations. So learning and evolution are related to each other, and it's clear how they differ. This is also important, this point of ontogenetic adaptation, because it shows how crucial learning is within psychology. It's really has this should have the same status as evolution in biology. It's about changes in the behavior of units and how these change as the result of irregularities in the environment of the organism during its life. So it defines what learning is and what learning is not. And it allows you to differentiate different types of learning. This is done based on different types of regularities. So we distinguish different classes of learning depending on the type of regularity that is involved. Let's start with effects of regularities that involve one stimulus. One example of that is habituation. So you have a single stimulus. For example, you see somebody with a face mask and you repeatedly see that stimulus. The first time that you see that stimulus, you might have a big orienting response. It might be surprising to see something with somebody with a face mask, might even be a bit scary. But the more often you see people with a face mask, the less intense your response becomes. So here we have a change in behavior. The intensity of your response decreases, and it's due to a regularity in the environment, namely the repeated presentation of people with face masks. This particular effect is called habituation, and its habituation is one example of an effect of regularities involving one stimulus. It is only one of this type of learning. You can also have sensitization, where a repeated stimulus, for example, repeatedly being exposed to loud noises of traffic, changes your response to the traffic. So initially your response is not so intense, but the more you are exposed to loud noise, the more intense your response becomes. Again, there is a change in behavior. Now the intensity of the response increases, and this increase is due to the repeated presentation of the stimulus. So it belongs to the same type as habituation. It's an effect of the repeated presentation of one stimulus, but the way in which behavior changes is different. It's an increase rather than a decrease. There are many other examples of effects of repeated stimulus presentations. For example, mere exposure in social psychology is one example. Changes in the dynamic of affect is an example that you often see, for example, with people who use drugs, and the responses to drugs can also be understood by looking at how the repeated use of a drug influences the response to it. So that's the first type of learning. All have in common here that they are effects of regularities in the presence of one stimulus. The second is type of learning are effects of regularities involving two stimuli, and we call those effects classical conditioning. Everybody knows classical conditioning, Pavlov's dog. For example, at the increased salivation by pairings of bell and food. So there's a regularity in the presence of the bell and the food, and this changes the response of the dog to the bell. Now, this is again just one example of classical conditioning. Again, we only look at the regularity that is important, that produces the change in behavior. So as long as it's a regularity involving two stimuli, we say that the change in behavior is classical conditioning. This means that we have a very broad view on conditioning, not just the conditioning of salivation responses, but also conditioning of fear responses or conditioning of evaluative responses. If you have a neutral stimulus that repeatedly is paired with a negative one, the neutral one will become more negative. This is also classical conditioning because there is a pairing of two stimuli, a regularity in the presence of two stimuli, which produces a change in your evaluative responses to the neutral one. Again, this belongs to the class of classical conditioning. Even human contingency learning can be seen as instances of classical conditioning, where, for example, you have a cue that is present. Somebody has eaten a certain food, and this leads to a certain outcome like a disease. And then you have four different types of situations. You have eaten the food and you have the disease. You have eaten the food, you don't have the disease. And then afterwards, people are asked to judge the contingencies between those stimuli. Now, those changes in contingency judgments are due to the pairing of stimuli. So within our definition of classical conditioning, evening, this qualifies as an instance of classical conditioning because there is a change in the behavior that is due to the pairing of two stimuli, to a regularity in the presence of two stimuli. So we have a really broad definition of classical conditioning, but it is clear what is in the class and what is not in the class. And the limit is of the class is defined by whether it are two, whether it's a regularity in the presence of two stimuli that causes the change in behavior. So then the third class are effects of regularities between stimuli and responses. Those are called operant conditioning. Everybody knows the rat of Skinner pressing the lever, which leads to food. It's because of the regularity in the presence of pressing the lever and the receiving the food, this regularity produces changes in behavior. So it falls within this third class, which is operant conditioning. Again, this is just one example of many instances of operant conditioning: punishment, avoidance, stimulus control, choice behaviors, tantrum and kids. All of this can be seen as changes in behavior that are due to regularities in the presence of a behavior and a stimulus in the environment. So that's the third class. And then there is a generative value of our heuristic framework. A heuristic framework is basically like a closet in which with different parts in the closet, and you can put things in. You can say, okay, this belongs there, this belongs there. But a good framework also shows you which closets haven't been filled, which part of the closets are still empty. And this is what our framework also does. For example, it has led us to the insight that behavior can also change as the result of multiple regularities. And this is the idea of complex learning that we will that I will return to at the end of the talk. So our definition really allows for us to organize the existing literature, but also see gaps in our knowledge that still need to be filled in. So that's the first advantage the first reason why our definition is a useful definition. A second reason is that it allows for different approaches in learning psychology. So a functional approach is really interested in explaining behavior. So functional psychologists want to understand why behavior changes. And in this case, so functional learning psychologists, they study the impact of regularities in the environment on behavior. It's important to note that this is a level of explanation, because the more you know about how regularities change behavior, the more you know about what the causes of behavior are, so the better your explanation and your understanding of behavior. A key term here is the term moderation. Functional people don't only want to know which regularities change behavior, but also under what conditions regularities change behavior. So it could be that the impact of regularities depends on the nature of the stimuli that you use, or the nature of the behavior that you look at, the nature of the organism, the broader context, or the exact regularity that is involved. All of these are potential moderators of the impact of regularities on behavior. So these are moderators of learning. And what is important here is that functional people don't simply construct piles of knowledge, so individual pieces of functional knowledge. They try to organize this in using analytic abstractive concepts like reinforcive punisher. Those are concepts that are not tied into a specific procedure, but that can be used to describe different procedures and different types of effects. So functional psychology strives for abstract concepts. The cognitive approach is not interested merely in the impact of regularities on behavior, but it wants to explain the impact of regularities on behavior. It wants to say, how is it possible that regularities in the environment produce changes in behavior? And they explain this using mental mechanism. So cognitive approach aims to explain behavior, and a key term here is mediation, is what is in between the environment and the behavior. What are the mental processes here by which the environment can change the behavior? Again, it's an abstractive exercise. People want to have abstract knowledge that applies to different procedures, different situations, and different effects. But it is it's a mental abstractive exercise rather than an analytic abstractive exercise. So this means that the two approaches are related in this way. So they both look for abstraction. They go beyond the observational structural level and beyond making links between elements. So for example, if you have a child, a parent who doesn't interact with the child, then the child throws a tantrum and the parents start interacting with the child. These are all things that you can observe without making any links. These are all separate events. Then a first level of scientific explanation is that you make links between these events, but your links are formulated in these specific terms within this specific situation. So you say that the tantrums, the kid has tantrums because it influences the behavior of the parents. That's an effect-centric explanation. And then you try to abstract out, you try to disengage yourself from the specific situation and go to a more abstract level. And this can be done analytic abstractively by using functional concepts or cognitively by using mental abstract concepts. And the functional cognitive framework basically separates these levels of explanation, but also says that they can interact. So you see that there are different ways in which the different levels of explanation can interact with each other. That's the functional cognitive framework. So within learning psychology, our functional definition of learning allows these cognitive level and functional level to exist next to each other. And we know what the difference is. But by making this difference between the two levels, we can also show how they can interact. So they each have their value. They're each levels of abstract explanation, but they abstract out in different ways that nonetheless can inform each other. All of this is also in the introductory chapter of the book. Okay, so a third advantage of our definition is that it allows for more theoretical freedom, theoretical in the sense of mental explanations. Because what we consistently do in the book is separate the functional level, the level of the moderators, from the mental level, the level of the mediators. And we really do that in all of the chapters, keep these two apart. And when you keep them apart, basically your freedom increases because you don't make a priori links between the functional and the cognitive level. You see them as clearly separated levels without a priori links, and that gives you more freedom. You are allowed to do more than when you make a priori links between those two levels. And this happens both at the level of specific learning effects, types of learning, and learning in general. Let's start at the level of specific learning effects. So often in books of learning psychology, you'll see terms like latent inhibition and blocking. Now, it's not important what this exactly means, but latent inhibition refers to a specific effect or a specific moderator of classical conditioning, namely the fact that if a CS is presented on its own, this will delay the conditioning afterwards, the impact of the CS-US. This is an effect. It's a moderator of classical conditioning, a moderator of the impact of parents on behavior. So you shouldn't define it in terms of a specific explanation of that effect. Inhibition is a mental construct that is designed to explain the effect. And what you often see is that cognitive psychologists tend to define effects in terms of potentially explanatory mechanisms. Like latent inhibition is basically a CS pre-exposure effect that could be explained by inhibitory processes. We avoid that consistently. We keep the effect separate from possible explanations. which is also good for the students, I think, to really think about effects separately from explanation. We also do that at the type of learning, very often in textbooks, but in the literature, definitely the cognitive literature, you see that, for example, classical conditioning is defined as association formation. So classical conditioning is said to be a mental process, namely the process of forming associations. We don't say that. We don't make any assumptions about mental processes that produce classical conditioning. We say that classical conditioning is an effect. It's the impact of stimulus pairings on behavior. And we don't say anything, our definition doesn't say anything about the mediating mechanisms. This means that we can look beyond association formation and, for example, also consider the formation of propositions as a potential explanation of classical condition. So we have more theoretical freedom. Even at the level of learning, we don't make assumptions. We only say that learning is the impact of regularities on behavior. We don't need any assumptions about the organism or the unit that learns. We can have even organisms that don't have a memory system or organisms that don't have a brain can in principle learn, because the only thing you need is that there are regularities in the environment of that unit and that those regularities can change the behavior of the unit. So you can look at learning also in plants or in parts of organisms or in non-living units like robots or in groups of organisms like societies. All you need is a unit that can behave and that can change its behavior. We'll say a bit more about this later. But this is, I think, an important advantage of consistently separating the functional level from the cognitive level, really gives you more theoretical freedom at all of these points, at the level of specific learning effects, types of learning, and learning in general. So I hope you agree that our definition of learning is a useful definition. And we really use this as the, as I said, the bedrock of our book, because the whole book is built on that idea, that definition of learning as an effect. We start with an introductory chapter where we define these issues. We define learning, we define the functional approach, the cognitive approach, and the relationship between them. That's the first chapter. It's a much more heavy chapter than you will see in typical learning books, but we made it so heavy because it's really the foundation of our book. And then we go to the different types of learning. So we have a first chapter that looks at effects of regularities in the presence of one stimulus. And there we first discuss environmental moderators. So what are, under which conditions do regularities in one stimulus change behavior? It's only after that that we look at mental theories of these effects. For example, theories of Sokolov, Bradley, and Solomon are cognitive theories for how it is possible that regularities in one stimulus change behavior. But there's a clear separation between the discussion of the moderators of these effects and the mediators of these effects. So this is chapter one. Chapter two is the same, but then regarding effects of regularities in the presence of two stimuli. So this is the chapter about classical conditioning. Again, we first discuss the environmental moderators and only then the mediators. Same for operant conditioning, first moderators, then mediators. And then we have a separate new chapter on complex learning, which I will talk about later, but again, first moderators, mediators. And then we have a final fifth chapter that again brings everything together and discusses applied learning psychology. So how can we use the insights produced by learning psychology, both functional and cognitive learning psychology, to apply this and to apply this in the real world, basically. So what is the utility of this knowledge? And that is discussed in chapter five. This is mainly applied behavior analysis, but we also discuss what cognitive psychology has contributed to this, which unfortunately is not that much. So the first strength of our book is that we have a unique conceptual foundation. I think it's really unique to our book that we have this strong foundation in conceptually, but also in philosophy of science, which might not be easy at first, but my experience is I teach this course in the second year here in Ghent, so the second year of the bachelor's, and students do get it. It is possible to communicate these ideas early on in their academic career. So how am I doing for time, Robert?
It's great. The original plan was to maybe end at about 5 p.m. and then have 15 minutes for question.
15 minutes left.
Okay.
Okay. So what is this? The second is that it's a unique overview of the literature. If you look at textbooks of learning psychology, you have cognitively inspired textbooks and functionally inspired textbooks. And surprisingly enough, there is a lot of in there that the overlap is only limited. And what we try to do in our book is, because we can have both approaches, we cover issues in both those books. So we have a broader range of topics that we discuss, because we don't just have a cognitive approach or just have a functional approach. We have a broader range of topics and views. We go in less detail, but the range of topics that we discuss is broad. And I'll focus on this now, because Robert informed me that most of you will have a background in behavior analysis or relational frame theory. So why is this book interesting for people with this background in behavior analysis? There is a really good book of learning from a behavior analytic perspective, and that's the Catania book, the Bible of learning in behavior analysis. So why would you need our book? Well, first of all, there's very little attention to cognitive theories in that book. Okay, for a behavior analyst, maybe you don't say that's not my core business, but it is good to know what this other breed of people, which are cognitive psychologists, what they are doing and how this generates research, because okay, there might be many problems with cognitive psychology, but one strength of cognitive psychology is that it generates many research results, and it's really generative. So it's good to know what is happening there. Also, if you look at behavior analytic books, there's a lot there on classical conditioning. It's only very little on classical conditioning. Typically also in Catania, I think it's one chapter on classical conditioning. Whereas if you look at other cognitive books like this book of Bouten, this is the best cognitive book, I think more than half of the book is about classical conditioning. And I think this is because behavioral analysts have typically a quite restricted view on classical conditioning as changes in respondent behavior. So behavior that is a function only of antecedents, stimuli in the environment, so basically reflexes. Of course, if classical conditioning is only about reflexes, then you don't need to pay a lot of attention to it. But from our definition, it's any change in behavior that is due to the pairing of stimuli. So even behavior that is also a function of its outcome can still be classically conditioned in the sense of be dependent on the pairing of two stimuli. And this basically broadens the scope. The functional people who work in my lab are always surprised by the wealth of knowledge there is about classical conditioning. And I think you can find more of that in our book than you can find in typical behavior analysis. What is also unique about our book is that we do discuss relational frame theory, which is this post-Skinnerian account of language and thinking. Again, we don't do it in much detail, but it is integrated within our conceptual framework for learning psychology. And we have a lot of new ideas that I will go into now. If it's good for you, Robert, I will not spend too much time on the added value of our book compared to cognitive textbooks, given that most of the people don't have a cognitive background. But actually, I think our book is even more useful for cognitive people, because typically in cognitive textbooks, there is a really impoverished vision on operant conditioning. So our book provides really a unique overview of the literature. But as I said, it is not just a textbook, but also a kind of monograph. It contains new ideas. One new idea is the functional cognitive framework. As I said, the book is a kind of showcase for this framework within the literature of learning. A second idea that I already touched upon is that our approach to learning really highlights that learning can not only be studied in individual animals, in human beings, or in rats, or in pigeons. I know in behavior analysis, there's always a talk about the organism. It's never clear what the organism is. What is clear from our definition, it doesn't have to be an animal. It can be a plant. It doesn't even have to be a living organism. It can be a robot or a machine. The only thing you need to study learning is a unit that can behave, that can change its behavior, and where you can examine whether the change in behavior occurs because of regularities. If you can establish this, so if you can establish that the change, that there is a change in the behavior of a unit, which is due to regularities, then you have learning. And once you have established learning in a unit, you can then examine similarities and differences in learning in that unit compared to other units. So you really create a much bigger space for learning psychology that goes beyond psychology, that goes into biology, that goes into computer science, that even goes into genetics. So in the book, we discuss learning in plants. There's habituation in this plant, and this plant can behave in that if you touch it, it closes its leaf. So if you touch this plant, the leaves are closed. So that's a behavior. There is a change in the state of the plant as the result of something in the environment, a stimulus in the environment, so it behaves. If you can repeatedly stimulate this plant, and that's an environmental regularity, so the repeated stimulation of this plant, and you can see that the repeated stimulation of a plant changes its behavior. Now, stimulation, which initially evokes a strong contraction of the leaf, will, after repeated stimulation, evoke weak contraction of the leaves. This is a change in behavior that could be due, and you need controls for that, but it could be due to a regularity in the environment. So it makes sense to study learning also in plants. We have a paper now about where we introduce the concept of genetic learning. So the genetic material is part of an organism, but it has states that respond to things in the environment. For example, maize, if you dehydrate maize, you will get an increased transcription of stress response genes. If you repeat dehydration, then this response gets more intense. So the level of transcription in those response genes, so the extent to which dehydration causes higher levels of, causes transcription will increase as a result of the repetition of dehydration. This paper is now submitted, and it's for us a very important paper because we really had to go back to basics and define behavior, define changes in behavior, and then define learning, not only in humans, but also in genetic material. In future, we want to repeat this exercise for groups, a unit that consists of schools of fishes, for example, or groups of humans, for machines and for humans. Again, really increasing the scope of learning psychology and connecting, going beyond psychology, but making contact with those other areas. And then we have the idea of complex learning. And now I have to look because I think I only have 5 minutes, right, Robert?
Yeah, that's correct. Feel free to use 10 if you need.
Yeah, I will go briefly because as you might expect, it's not difficult, the idea of complex learning, but the complex, it becomes basically, it's just increasing levels of complex. So simple learning can be defined as the effect of a single regularity on behavior, like the pairing of two stimuli. Complex learning we define as the joint effects of multiple regularities on behavior. And here we make a distinction between moderated learning and effects of meta-regularities. Very briefly, moderated learning, there are a lot of known moderated learning effects, like sensory preconditioning is an instance of moderated learning where you have two CSs represented together. This is a first regularity. Then the CS2 is presented with the US. This is the second regularity. And as the joint effect of these two regularities, you see that CS1 also evokes the conditioned response. So the response to CS1 changes as the result, not of any of these two separately, but because of the joint impact of those two regularities. Now, when we look at the literature from this perspective, we noticed that many of these moderated learning effects occur because regularities have elements in common. Like here, the two regularities have this CS in common. And this generated the idea of effects of intersecting regularities, where we have different types of regularities that all have elements in common. And we show that as soon as two regularities have something in common, you'll see learning effects resulting. You see changes in behavior as the result of those multiple regularities. Again, I cannot go into this. We have described this in a JEP general paper, of which Sean is the first. Finally, meta-regularities are basically regularities in the presence of regularities. So basically, as researchers, we can look at the environment and see meta-regularities. For example, in this is an example of non-arbitrarily applicable relational responding. This basically means that you have to select the bottom symbol that is identical to the top one. So this is identical, so select this one. This is identical, so select that. If you look at this procedure, I, as a researcher, can construct this as a meta-regularity, meaning that there are multiple regularities in there. The mere presence of these two, for example, I can construct as being a regularity. And this regularity is part of a bigger operant regularity, because it's basically this regularity signals what I should do and what the outcome of a picking response will be. If I pick this one, then I'll get the feedback that I'm right. So you have an overall operant regularity of which the two symbols here is part. It's part of this. It's a regularity within an overarching regularity. Now, the big interesting thing about meta-regularities is that they allow for the study of relations. Because as soon as you have two stimuli, you can not only look at the properties of one stimulus, but you can also look at the relation between properties of different stimuli. So these two stimuli have the relation of having the same identity. So these symbols have the same identity. So meta-regularities allow you to study relations, and we have called this study of relational learning. And relational learning we define as effects of regularities with relations as stimuli. Now, last point I will make here is that this is not so new in a sense, or not so different from what we know. Because basically the only thing that we are doing is we are defining a stimulus class on the basis of a relation. So we are saying that this stimulus, so the thing that is functioning as an SD, as a discriminative stimulus, is defined not by individual stimulus features, but by the relation features. So actually, we define relational learning as effects of regularities in which relations are stimuli. This means you have stimulus classes in which relations are the unit that defines this stimulus class. Everything in which two stimuli have the same identity fall within that class of stimuli. So the unit that defines the class is a relation. And once you have done that, then things start exploding. Then you can really start studying relational learning as you study normal learning. You have different types of relational regularities, so different types of relational learning. You have classical relational learning, operant relational learning, effects of repeated presentations of relations, And you can study that relations have effects as of an SD, of a CS, of a US. Relational learning requires contextual control. I will not go into this, but I'll encourage you to read this in chapter 4, because this then brings us to a whole new function of relations and regularities, where relations can have the function of a contextual cue, which signals how to respond to relations. Again, I don't have time to go into that. I encourage you to do it because it has far-reaching implications for learning psychology, but I don't have the time now to go into that. Even learning via analogy, for example, I can then, from this perspective, you can look at really complex learning processes like learning via analogy. And again, this broadens the scope of learning psychology away from simple learning to complex learning. For me, this is an important idea, because when I started to teach learning psychology, I always said to my students, well, it's not really about studying. So learning psychology is not about studying, but it is about simple forms of learning. I think we can go beyond that now. It is not just simple forms of learning. We can even go to learning via analogy, and then we are very close to what happens in education. So I hope I have convinced you that our book has some unique strengths, that it has a unique conceptual foundation, that it provides a unique overview of the literature, and that it presents some unique new ideas. So please do read the book. I hope you will enjoy it and encourage your students and other colleagues to read the book and go to our website. And thank you for your time in being present here.
Thank you very, very much, Sean. And so the floor is open for about 12 minutes for questions. Feel free, anyone, to ask Sean questions.
Maybe if I may start with the question, thank you for the presentation. I think I actually failed to see the unique value of the concept. I need to read more. It sounds to me like you could basically replace the concept of regularity with environmental events or correlations in environmental events. What would be different? What's unique about the term regularities? For example, when you talk about novel behavior, you talk about intersecting regularities, but it doesn't explain who observes these intersections and who does not, and why novel behavior occurs in some instances and not in others.
So the conceptual framework doesn't explain anything, but it offers you a language, and I think the concept of regularity you can use to improve your functional analysis and to improve your the cognitive explanation of those effects. Why is this? let's go to, for example, arbitrarily applicable relational responding. If you don't have the concept of a regularity, then in principle, you would say that anything that a verbal human being does is arbitrarily applicable relational responding, because anything can be seen, any behavior can be seen as relational responding in an arbitrary way. The concept of a regularity allows you as a researcher to make distinctions in your environment. You can say, okay, there are different types of events in the environment, and you use the term regularity to make distinctions between different types of events. This does not mean that these distinctions will be consequential, not by definition, but at least it allows you to explore that are, for example, arbitrarily applicable relational responding is not this unique or this wholly uniform phenomena, but there might be subclasses of arbitrarily applicable relational responding where there are different moderators depending on the type of regularity that is guiding that behavior. So for example, to make it concrete, what is typically happening in arbitrarily applicable relational responding is that matching to sample tasks are used to induce arbitrarily applicable relational responding. From our perspective, this is just one type of regularity. It involves operant regularities with relationships as these. But also pairings can function as it's a different regularity. Also pairings of stimuli can induce arbitrarily applicable relational responding. And it is possible that the type of regularity that is responsible for your behavior and for your learning determines also that there are different moderators. So it's basically an additional instrument that you have as a functional researcher to analyze your environment and to examine the functions of elements in your environment.
So you would say it adds another dimension, or it adds more specificity to the analysis.
It could add more specificity. So if you would read the book, you would see that we pay more attention to what people might call the descriptive level.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a concept like a stimulus class, you can say there is a descriptive stimulus class and there is a functional stimulus class.
Yeah.
The descriptive stimulus class you can define in terms of the features of individual elements or something like that. But so we basically say that you can also, as a researcher, say that at the descriptive level, use terms like like regularities, relations, to make more distinctions at that descriptive level, and then see whether those different distinctions have different functional properties. And I think it's something that functional psychologists always do. They always use a descriptive level, but they do it in a way that is less systematic, and that can use more complexity.
Okay, thank you.
So Emil has the next question.
Yes, thank you for your presentation and also for the book that you have written. I've started reading it, but I haven't gotten through it yet. I also have a question about the definition, because the way it's phrased, it's about the change in behavior. And for me, it would feel more natural to define learning in terms of a change in a stimulus response relation. To specify that it's in connection to a specific stimulus and not just behavior in general. What's your view on that kind of modification?
It's a good point, because indeed it is, for us, we define behavior as a change in the state of a unit due to a particular stimulus. So the element of stimulus response relation is part of our definition of behavior. So when we say that a behavior changes, we say that a stimulus changes the state of a unit in a different way. So it first changes the state of a unit in this direction, and then afterwards it changes it in another direction or less intensely or something like that. So the stimulus response relationship concept is part of our definition of behavior.
And just a follow up on that. So yeah, I can see your point there. As a question related to that is that a definition that specifies that it's a change in stimulus response relation also puts the emphasis on the relation, which in cognitive terms might be seen as the more like true thing instead of the actual behavior. Do you have any comment on that?
Yeah, so I had long discussions with Sean about this, because he was also very tied into this ontology idea. We should not make any assumptions about reality. And again, we are not doing that. We're simply, me as a researcher, I'm looking at the environment, I'm defining what stimuli are, I'm defining what responses are. I'm examining whether a behavior is a function of a stimulus. So I'm not assuming any mechanism or simply staying within the level of functional causation. So there's no assumption about ontology. It's all me as a researcher trying to find a way to improve my prediction and influence But I think what I do differently in the book, and my colleagues in my functional colleagues here in Ghent also have always had difficulty with that, is that I pay more attention to the structural level. I try to put more complexity there. And this is, I think, something that can benefit benefit the functional analysis also. And again, functional researchers are always doing it. If you say that a red object is functioning as an SD, you're saying there is something red there, not in an ontological way, but you say, okay, I make the assumption for my analysis that there is something like a red object. And this then you can go and examine whether it has certain functions.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I have a question. You mentioned your colleagues in Ghent there from in the functional lab, and in the recent, how to say, 2020 version of RFT, they argue with the field as the unit with the relating and orienting and evoking, interacting, would you say that this very general framework that you present with interacting regularities and meta-regularities could reason about that, those phenomena too?
Well, I must say I haven't studied that in detail, as far as I know, that this refers mainly to different types of function, like orienting functions. One should also take into account, and they can change in particular ways. So it's in a sense an extension of functions, and so you can also apply the ideas in the book to those functions. What with complex learning, for example, what happens there is that we emphasize the idea that relations or relating, that's the difference. Relations can be used at the descriptive level, and then at the behavioral functional level, it's relating. And so it are two things, but relations, they can also have the functions of a CREL or functions of a CFunc. And then once you entertain that idea, you come into things like a complex relations between CRELs and CFunks and interactions between CRELs and CFunks. And this can be captured within the idea of complex learning. So my response is as two levels. As far as RF 2020 RFT is concerned, part of it is additional functions that are taken into account, and that's just like any other function, you can use it within the framework of the book. And the idea of complex learning really, I think, and we are doing the studies now, can provide new ways of new ideas of seeing how CRELs and CFunks interact with each other.
Okay, so the time is up. So I think we close there, unless someone has a very short last comment.
Just thanks and congratulations on the book and the achievement to make it freely available. It's a great thing.
Yeah, we really hope, Sean, that people will continue to know about this work and hope that it will lead to a lot of fruitful discussions in psychology departments where people, unfortunately, sometimes work on in completely different countries almost. So I hope this will lead to many interesting discussions.
I have a super short question, Robert.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Is there a limitation in the number of downloads with the free version of the book?
No.
No, great.
We still own the copyright and
So you can recommend it to students and stuff and they can just download it freely.
Yeah,
great.
Yeah, this is really unique with such an such a material that is this much available. So very, I hope that it really takes off into the learning courses. Okay, so thank you so much, Sean, for doing this. And thank you everybody for listening. And I will, anybody who wants to have the YouTube link to this can email me after John has approved it. So thanks a lot, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.